Hi, I'm Bobby Pritt, Director of the Clinical Parasitology Laboratory and Vice Chair of Education in the Department of Laboratory Medicine and Pathology at Mayo Clinic. Did you know that drawing blood from a patient's arm with intravenous infusion running has the potential risk for erroneous and misleading laboratory test results? In this month's hot topic, Dr. Brad Karon will discuss what laboratory test results are adversely affected when drawing from an arm with an IV running and what the phlebotomist can do to minimize these errors. I hope you enjoy this month's hot topic, and I want to personally thank you for allowing Mayo Clinic the opportunity to be a partner in your patient's healthcare.
Thank you for the introduction. For those of you who have not attended our phlebotomy conference here in Rochester, the title of my topic today, Phlebotomy Top Gun, may seem a little odd. I hope I'll be able to explain to you what is Phlebotomy Top Gun and what we try to do at our annual phlebotomy conference. I have no disclosures relevant to today's presentation. Every year at Mayo Medical Laboratory's Phlebotomy Conference, I present a talk that's always called Phlebotomy Top Gun. The format of Phlebotomy Top Gun is a case-based presentation. I solicit from you, the attendees, cases, issues, or questions that you would like to hear about. I present these as case-based scenarios, and using an audience response voting mechanism, the attendees of the conference vote on the action or answer they feel is appropriate to the case. I then present the collective experience from our practice and the evidence and data that I can find relevant to the topic. At the end of the case, the attendees vote again. For each case, I can see whether I have been able to change anyone's mind on the question at issue by presenting the data and information relevant to the topic. This is an actual case from a Phlebotomy Top Gun presentation at a previous phlebotomy conference in Rochester. In this case, the question was, in a patient with an IV catheter, you may draw from the same arm that has the IV catheter if the first choice or answer from the audience would be, you may only draw above the IV. The second choice would be, you can draw below the IV with a tourniquet between the IV site and the draw site. The third choice would be, you can only draw from the opposite arm. And the fourth choice would be, the available data suggests that the second and third options are equally appropriate. At this point during the live conference, attendees using an audience response system would vote for the answer they thought was most appropriate, and we would get to see in real time the distribution of results that our audience felt was correct. Cases often start with a review of the relevant CLSI guidelines. In this case, the applicable CLSI guideline is CLSI GP41 Edition 7, also called Collection of Diagnostic Venous Blood Specimens. The guidelines note that there is a risk of obtaining erroneous and misleading results when drawing blood from a patient with an IV catheter. The guidelines recommend using the opposite arm, not the arm with the IV catheter, whenever possible, and when not possible, collecting the specimen below or distal to the IV site. CLSI guidelines go on to give recommendations about techniques for drawing below or distal to an IV catheter, recommending that the IV be turned off for 2 minutes or longer, and that a tourniquet be placed between the IV site and the blood draw site. Finally, the guidelines mention that collection above or proximal to the IV catheter is not recommended, and should be done only when all other options for blood collection have been exhausted. Getting back to the question in the case, to find an answer, we should go further and investigate the data in studies that were mentioned or referred to in the CLSI guideline and data from any other studies or relevant Mayo Clinic experience. The first study I want to discuss was published some time ago in 1983. These investigators measured a complete blood count and various chemical parameters in 18 healthy individuals who did not have an IV in place or running. A peripheral IV was then started and fluids were allowed to infuse for 30 minutes. Samples were then drawn from above and below the IV site and from the opposite arm while the IV catheter was running. The IV fluids were then shut off for 2 minutes and samples were drawn a third time from the IV catheter site. A number of hematological and chemical parameters were different from the baseline values when the specimen was drawn from above the IV catheter while fluids were running. Glucose and phosphate were different from baseline when they were drawn either below the IV site or from the opposite arm. Keeping in mind that for this experiment, the IV fluids were not turned off for collections. When the IV was turned off, there were no differences in glucose or phosphorus collected below the IV versus in the other arm. Drawn from the IV site after a 2-minute pause in IV fluids also seemed to work fairly well. Another study on this subject, even older, was performed in 1979. Using a similar design, the investigators compared chemical and hematological parameters in individuals with a peripheral IV running. By either using a tourniquet between the IV site and draw site and drawing below the IV, or from drawing in the other arm. Again, this experiment, the below IV site and other arm were compared while the IV fluid was running. For the complete blood count and 18 chemical parameters analyzed, only glucose values showed any difference between the below the IV draw site and the draw from the opposite arm. The glucose concentration was quite a bit higher by around 43 milligrams per deciliter when it was drawn from below the IV site, even with the tourniquet in place, as opposed to drawing from the other arm. The final study published on this subject I will discuss is more recent, although not that recent, having been done in 1988. In this study, 24 healthy volunteers had solutions of 5% dextrose in normal saline infused through an IV for 20 minutes. The IV was then stopped and samples were collected above or proximal to the IV site and from the other arm at 1, 2, and 3 minutes after the IV solution was stopped. Values for sodium, chloride, red blood cell count, and glucose were comparable between arms at 1, 2, and 3 minutes after stopping the IV solution. The values were also compared to baseline values obtained before the IV solution was infused. Values for sodium, chloride, and red cell count were close to baseline values, whether collected above the IV or from the other arm, by around 1 minute after stopping the IV solution. In contrast, glucose values in the arm with the IV were much higher than in the opposite arm. Glucose values began to come back down to baseline values by 2 to 3 minutes after the IV was stopped, though values remained around 5 to 10 milligrams per deciliter higher in the arm with the IV compared to the opposite arm. These authors concluded that the dilutional effect of collecting proximal to or above an IV, even when the solution is stopped for only a minute, is fairly minimal. However, if a substance being infused, glucose in this case, is going to be measured, then a 2 to 3 minute pause is necessary to achieve accurate values. These particular authors recommended a 3 minute pause, and this data is really the source of the recommendation for a 2 to 3 minute pause in IV fluids before blood draw. Within our practice at Mayo, we have an IT system used in our central and stat laboratories that allows us to detect patterns of results that likely represent contamination with IV fluids. In these cases, we most often initiate a redraw for these specimens. If the results with a redrawn specimen are different from the original, we confirm that specimen contamination did in fact occur on the first draw. Therefore, in our practice, we have obtained over a large time a database of types of contaminated specimens. In our practice, we find that falsely elevated glucose concentrations represent one of the most common contamination scenarios for patients with venous catheters. We've collected dozens, if not hundreds, of instances where glucose concentrations were falsely elevated when IV fluids were not paused for at least 2 minutes, even if we document that specimens were drawn from the opposite arm as the IV. Both existing evidence and our experience suggest that contamination is worse when drawn from below the IV site than the opposite arm, but that neither procedure, drawing below the IV with a tourniquet or drawing from the opposite arm, is a reliable way to measure glucose when an intravenous solution that contains glucose is currently running. Pausing the IV fluid is necessary to obtain accurate glucose concentrations in patients with intravenous fluids being administered that do contain glucose. Intravenous replacement of calcium, magnesium, and phosphorus is also very common among acutely or critically ill patients. Contamination of specimens among patients receiving intravenous calcium, magnesium, or phosphorus replacement is a special case that merits a brief discussion. calcium, phosphorus, and magnesium undergo redistribution between the vascular space and the cellular compartments. Reaching equilibrium for these electrolytes likely takes an hour or more rather than just 2 or 3 minutes. The electrolyte replacement protocols at our institution recommend that calcium, magnesium, and phosphorus levels be drawn no sooner than 2 hours after the termination of an intravenous infusion of any of these electrolytes in order to avoid false elevations. While there is a false elevation that results from drawing the calcium, magnesium, or phosphorus level too soon after the IV infusion has finished, these specimens are not truly contaminated in that the blood concentration measured at this time is analytically accurate, but it does not reflect the true value that will be observed once the cellular equilibrium is reached. Although there's not a lot of data published on this issue, it is likely that the site of draw, that is, below the IV catheter with a tourniquet or from the opposite arm, is less important than the timing of the blood draw for calcium, magnesium, and phosphorus relative to when intravenous infusions are stopped. At this point during phlebotomy conference, I would return to the original question that I polled the audience on. The attendees of the conference would use the audience response system to respond again, and I would share with the audience what I believe to be the correct or intended response. Based on the available data and our collective experience here at Mayo, my opinion is the single best answer to this question would be option 4. The available data suggests that collection below the IV with the tourniquet and from the opposite arm as the IV are equally effective approaches to collecting blood from a patient with an IV. Although not explicitly asked or stated in the question, a minimum of a 2-minute pause of IV fluids is highly desirable and perhaps more important than the choice of site in terms of avoiding contamination. Thank you for your time and attention today. If you liked today's presentation, or even if you didn't, please consider attending a future Mayo Medical Laboratories Phlebotomy Conference. We hold the conference in the spring each year. Learning takes place via both large group didactic sessions and small breakout sessions that allow more interaction with conference speakers. Tours of Mayo Clinic facilities are also offered during the conference. Thank you for listening and have a wonderful day.